This episode may contain strong language and adult themes. Viewer and listener discretion is advised.
This is not a test. This is rock and roll. It's time to rock it from the Delta to the DMZ. Hey, is that me or does that sound like an Elvis Presley movie? Oh, viva denang. Denang me. Going to gather rope and hang me. Hey, is it a little too early for being that late? Hey, too late. It's 0600. What's the O stand for? Oh my God!
God, it's early.
It's time for Good Morning Las Vegas. How you doing,
guys.
Phil?
Good morning. Actually, it's like Good Morning Rugby fans.
I like that one. It doesn't quite work with Good Morning Inverness, does it?
No, don't even go there because it's not morning, it's evening.
Yeah, it is. Listen, it's the magic of tally. Shut up. Nobody else knows it's the evening. You've just ruined it for all those people.
You're drinking. Of course, if they don't realise it's the evening and you're drinking, you've got a serious alcohol problem. Oh, yeah, that's right. You have.
Anyway. Anyway, we're a little bit depleted tonight because Sam's not going to join us. Lawrence may be joining us from Kenya when he's wound up his internet on his bicycle. He says he's going to try and get on for a bit later after the break. Christopher's had to go out to celebrate his mummy's birthday.
Happy birthday, mummy.
Happy birthday, no. Maybe she just got no other friends that can celebrate with her, so she has to take him. And Tom's had to go out with his family. Because they're going to miss him when he goes back to university. Tom, they do know it's 2 weeks away yet, so is this going to be an ongoing thing every night?
Every Monday night.
It will be every Monday night. Ian might join us. It all depends on workload. And as of about 6 o'clock tonight, he was trying to get away. Now, what a show we've got lined up for you all tonight. If you saw the episode last week with Peter Bracken, we humbly apologise. And Peter humbly apologises for his internet connection and his dodgy camera on his phone as well. So three times an apology to anybody who watched last week's show. But hopefully you laughed as much as we did. The difference is we did it live and had to edit it all out. Now, you may have seen a couple of weeks ago, we were talking with one of the Wasps legends, the fabulous Peter Scrivener. And he's done us a wonderful favour tonight. And we've got, as you can tell, some more Wasps legends coming on. And after the break, you can find out who they are. But I assure you, from the showreels we've got, you are not going to be disappointed in what they've been doing over lockdown. A few people have been doing some different things over lockdown because a few people have been practicing their tackle technique at the weekend, haven't they, James?
That wasn't a tackle technique. That was just crazy. If you're talking about Mr. Farrell.
I might be.
Yeah, I think that is absolutely, utterly disgusting. And that is exactly what World Rugby is trying to get rid of. However, I think there are other issues around that, the way it was dealt with. Where the official actually put himself in a point of danger, and I think we need to talk about that as well, because if that had seriously kicked off, which it could have easily have done, he would have been in the thick of that and not able to protect himself.
So go on, because there are going to be people on here who perhaps don't understand or know. Just explain what referee Christoph Ridley did and why that was an issue for you.
It was an issue for me because as soon as Farrell did it, he sprinted 10, 12 metres and stood over Farrell as if he was protecting him. He's blown the whistle. Of course, he's blown the whistle, but players will be players. And I think he was very lucky that the players responded the way that they did. However, putting himself over the top of him, had those players decided to erupt, the Saracens players would have protected Farrell. the opposition would have come in and he would have been stuck right in the middle of that with probably 16 forwards wanting a piece of each other.
It's a very tricky situation, that is. Where do you go? How close do you get? We're often told not to get too close, even at try time, with players coming over and over the line and falling over. Phil, what's your take on this?
Well, my question is rhetorical. I mean, I can't think of a situation where a referee would put themselves in a situation to protect the violator. It just doesn't. If anything, you go over and protect the person that was just hurt by the tackle. But I'm not really sure why. So my question comes down to is, why would anybody actually do that unless you were the player of the team? I just don't get it. None of us train or coach match officials to get in the way of a confrontation or a potential confrontation. We always sit back and acknowledge, and observe, right? But I'm not sure why anybody would have done that.
I can't see how he would have been in a position to protect himself if it had all kicked off. And moreover, he wouldn't have been in a position to see who came running in and who did what to who. You go on to that and then you look at how Wayne Barnes dealt with the punch towards the end of the game, and he yellow carded one player and he red carded the other. Well, the player that was yellow carded has now been cited, and
I agree that I think it was an instinct for Christoph, whatever that instinct was, to go and stand over Owen and stop anything escalating. But with the Wayne Barnes one, I don't think from what he saw initially. So if you look at it, the two of them were grappling a little bit on the floor anyway, and he had to wait with those two. They broke up and then play carried on. It was after play then stopped that the Worcester player, the 19, came over, and he's the one that instigated the next confrontation. Now, as he grabbed the other player, what you didn't see until a replay is that he gets a good clock on the head as well from the extra player in the red scrum hat. Then it all goes to floor. The Worcester player is giving it large as well, right in front of Wayne. So I can see why Wayne did what he did. The instigator was always the Worcester player. The thing that Wayne saw most was the Worcester player aiming punches at the head of a player on the floor. What you couldn't see until you got the opposite camera angle was that he'd taken one for the team as well.
I have no issue with what Wayne did. Absolutely no issues. The only thing he could have done, he could have just taken that half a step back, gone upstairs and asked the question, I have one punch to the head. Is there anything else I need to be looking at?
He did say, he went through a process of, look, I'm going to tell you what I've got, what I've seen. Please step in.
I don't know why you guys are spending all your time talking about shit rugby. You should be spending your time talking about the North-South game in New Zealand.
Yeah, no, I haven't seen this yet, mate. Do tell us.
It was a spectacular match. Right from the opening kickoff right to the extra time. It's an excellent match to watch. It was open play. It was wide open.
Really?
I think it was around 68, 69 points scored. No determination outcome to the very, very end. And, it was physical. They played hard against each other. And, it's top-notch rugby. It's just fantastic to watch.
Listen, just before we go to our first break tonight, we've got to take an opinion poll, because we do. We're never right. But then again, this is the 22 dropouts, and we're never right. So I'm going to start this one off. Now, bearing in mind, I would charge Owen Farrell with attempted murder at the moment. I mean, let's face it. You can't say it was a reckless tackle, because it just wasn't even a tackle. He went... A sniper couldn't have got him better in the side of the head, all right, from 100 yards. So I'm charging Owen Farrell with attempted murder this week. On that basis, I must go to the highest level. I reckon 16 weeks. However, even if they go 16 weeks, they're going to go, ooh, it's Owen Farrell. I don't think he's going to serve any more than 8 weeks. What say you, gentlemen?
Okay, so my opinion, I think he's going to get 8 to 10 weeks. for a few reasons. One is because, you know, I hate to say it, but he is Owen Farrell, and they're going to justify something that is not as egregious as apparently it looks on camera, blah, blah, blah. I tend to agree with you, Mike. I think it's a high end point, but I think there'll be mitigating that comes in there, and they'll bring it down to that 8 to 10 week. My big question out of this is that, does that take away his captaincy for the British Lions?
Yeah, so for me, I fully agree. When I first saw it and we were all talking on WhatsApp, I said straight away, that's 8 to 12 weeks. Without a doubt, if that had been a club rugby game, we'd have written the report. It was dangerous and reckless, with no thought for the safety of the player that he was tackling. However, I think that they'll go midpoint and they'll give him 6 weeks and it'll be mitigated down to 3. 50% mitigation, I think that's what they'll do.
To me, the standard of application of the law, the outcome, and the, again, we're not measuring the intent, but the outcome and the severity to it, if you lower that standard down to a 3 week ban as an example, I think that sets it up really, really bad for adjudication and other platforms.
Right, well, let's see what happens when we get the results, and by this time next week we'll be able to tell you, and we'll probably chat about it a lot more. But right now we're going to take a quick break, but we'll be back with you and our special guests right after this.
When you need clear and concise match official communication systems, look no further than the brand new AXIWEE AT350.
Radios are always, that they're always useful, they always help us, especially AXIWEEs, where all three of us can be open at any time, we can have open communication.
Available now from refcomsglobal.net. Investing profits into match official development worldwide.
Welcome back to the second part of the 22 Dropouts tonight. It's a good job you lot have not been party to what we've been talking about, because none of us have got a clue what's going on tonight. Anyway, we have finished talking about Owen Farrell, at least for now. I'm sure that the judge will put the black cap on when he sentences him to death for attempted murder later in the week. And we'll all see when he goes back to rugby after he's been hanged as well. And that's my mother-in-law now ringing their house phone because she couldn't get through on my mobile. So I forgive the noise in the background. Anyway, never mind mother-in-laws, because we have got the mother of rugby. We have got a member of the Front Row Union. She played years at Quinns and then transferred to the mighty Wasps. And where did they play her? On the wing, of course. Now, if Tom was with us tonight, he would say that Quinns got it right and Wasps clearly don't know what they're doing. However, on her debut at wing, she managed to score 5 tries. She went on to play over 20 times for England. She is now also the council member for women's and girls rugby. It is the princess of the front row, the queen of the turf. It is Lou Latter. Hi, Lou. How are you?
Well, yeah, I'm good. Thank you for that introduction. That's me done for the night now, I think.
Easily pleased then.
Yeah,
easily pleased.
Yeah.
Joining Lou as well from the Wasps Legends tonight is one of the perhaps most outspoken of ex-Wasps players. This is what happens when you go into coaching. Sometimes silence is golden. But this man has led his career by travelling around the world, leading from the front, and usually followed by Simon Amor a couple of years later on. He's been everywhere. He has done everything in rugby. He's the man. He's the Lord of Twickenham. He's the Marquis of the Seven Series. He is Mr. Ebenezer Good. He is the Sir, the Lord, the Prince, Mike Friday.
Good evening, all.
How are you, mate?
Well, I didn't realise I was royalty. I'm normally the peasant. So
I think, given what you've done with the sevens, mate, I think you're definitely not down there. In fact, I'm sure there's a few people who would like you to come and sort out the England sevens and maybe the Welsh sevens. In fact, mate, just take sevens over in the world. just run it, will you?
We've got to get it back up and running quickly, that's for sure.
You're damn right about that. Absolutely. I'm sure we'll talk about that a little bit later on as well. And lastly tonight, but definitely not least, this man probably requires the least of all introduction. He certainly doesn't need his name pushed up because he is already an OBE. He played 23 games in the second back row for England. He started where all legends start, at Fylde Rugby Club. He did finish a Wasp, and as they say, once a Wasp, always a Wasp. It's the man who played in the 1974 Lions Tour. He captained England five times. It's the one, the only, the guy who has got more stories than he will ever, ever let on. It's Mr. Roger Uttley. How are you doing, Roger?
Good evening, Mike. Yeah, very well, thank you. Nice to be with everybody.
Oh, it's lovely to see you,
mate. Conversation.
Yeah, you're looking rather suntan there.
Well, it's, you know, it's been a very good summer, hasn't it, really? And when you get to my age, you can spend a lot of time knocking about in the garden.
Phil, what are you wearing, son?
I'm protecting you all from catching the virus virtually.
There is a tradition amongst Wasps supporters and, more importantly, legends, and that is the Wasps salute and the EG. Now, I'm really, really interested in how you're going to perform this with that mask on, because the rest of us are going to now perform, led by Lou, because if you watch this now, you'll see just what Lou got up to during the summer.
Aloha? Nope. I am Spartacus. So, not my usual breakfast routine. To the wingers and a nod to props as well. Right. Left hand.
So, I'm going to try beer this time. EG? Excuse me. So, salute to the greatest club in the world that is Wasps. Salute to the Wasps Legends Charitable Foundation and all the money we've been raising during lockdown. I am going for my standard blackcurrant vodka. So, cheers.
Oh, you got a small drink. Oh, here we go.
Oh, there you go. No, EG, don't get carried away.
A short drink.
Did Mike salute anybody? Did he just drink his drink?
No, he just drank his drink.
I think he just drank his drink. I think that's...
This can only get worse.
You want Mike?
It was a bit warm under these studio lights.
Again, did you not read the instructions to how to play the game?
So, I'm just taking the leaf out of Geezer's book. And everybody just wave goodnight to Phil because he's got to go to a meeting because he lives in Las Vegas.
Night,
Phil. Catch you next week, mate. Man.
Cheers, guys. Be safe.
Keep smiling.
I am.
Now, I've been watching, as you can see now, if you have a watch of Geezer's video right now, you'll see the same schoolboy error that I've made that he made in the summer.
Let's get on with this. Okay, we're going to neck. We're going to nominate, and then we're going to donate. Something different this week. Be a nice bottle of red, shout out to the pap, you know the crack. Maestro, cue some music for me. Are you taking the piss? Oi!
Thank you.
articles. It's a wasp way. It's a wasp way.
Whatever.
Whinging quins. Whinging quins.
It's a good job I got two out the garage, isn't it? Right. It's a bit heavy, I've got to say.
Just be very careful.
Don't remember right. To
eat. Yeah, well, Rod, no coaching, my man.
Oh, sorry.
That's a fine in itself, is it not?
Oh, don't
it's all right, start. James. You're next. Lawrence, I hope you've got a bloody beer ready tonight, man.
Do you see why you have to get it right first time? Because you could be drinking a lot tonight. Yeah.
Yeah, right. Okay. So, right. Well, it looks like I'm following the great and the good that is Mr. Mike Friday. I'm hoping I'm not getting wrong as much as he did on that video. So, I am going to salute to the Wasps Legend Foundation. I'm going to salute the three glorious Wasps that are with us tonight. Lou, Mike and Rog, this is for you. This is for everybody that takes part in everything that you guys do and raises a huge amount for charity.
EG. Very good.
I think it is certainly time for Mr. Friday to do his drink because I think he's missed out.
I have, but you know, never fear. Geezer's here.
Geezer!
Salute to the Wasps. A salute to the Wasp Foundation. We'll be just having a little recognition for Toddy. Toddy's good, isn't it, sir? I love that music. Good choice.
Absolutely.
Cool.
In your own time.
I think father of the group there has demonstrated enough with you, and
I can't see Mike, so apologies, Mike, that just slipped out.
Yeah, you might have to just swipe left or right across your phone.
Oh right, yeah.
You see, I was going to say, Mike, I am standing up as
well. There you are.
I am standing up.
Hello, Lawrence, as well.
Now, Lou, things like that would never happen in the women's game, would they?
Oh, no, completely not. No, we're very law-abiding citizens when it comes to tackling in the women's game.
At the moment.
apart from the pulling of the ponytails, now that...
Well, yeah, then that's shocking.
I tell you what, that's worse, I think, because it's like, oh, look, I can get it, I'm going to get it.
But you know, I don't think players automatically think I can get the ponytail. I think it's just your natural instinct that you've got to make the tackle, and actually the sort of ponytail is what's the thing that you're going to get hold of. But it's so dangerous. I've been tackled that way, and actually... it's got to be the same. Yeah.
I don't have that problem.
I've had to penalise for other pulling of hair in a game.
Oh. Okay, right, time out there.
is that a women's game or a men's game, though?
No, it was a women's game, and the girl came up to me, she said, with a skipper, and she said, "Ref, can you stop her pulling my pubes, please?" And it's, before I could say anything, her skipper said, "Well, you know what to do at half-time, get off and get a razor."
So I used to have my sort of nipples and breast pinched in the front row, but yeah, I've never heard that one, but yeah, there you go.
Well, Lou, do tell us what else used to happen in the front row of women's games back then in the day.
just about that, probably about it. Yeah, a bit of.
I'm just asking because I think Lawrence is quite interested. I'm not going to embarrass Lou today about what Lawrence.
He's got a chicken farm, and a chicken farm has to have a server, so you can work that out. Oh, there it is.
Okay, there you go, the big cock. Well, congratulations, Lawrence.
Now you're congratulating him.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Lawrence, how do you feel now?
I'm a superhero now.
Now, listen, because we do want to talk something serious tonight, and one of those things is we heard a little bit from Scribs about the work of the Wasps Charitable Foundation, and particularly the work that they've done over the last few years, and giving some money to Doddy, who, you know, great sea geezers using Genius Lager, which is giving 5 pence from every can to the Doddy Weir Foundation. I know you guys have done a lot for Doddy in the past few years. What have you got coming up now that we're perhaps coming out of lockdown? But Lou, you've been one of the trustees for a number of years, haven't you?
Yeah, I'd step down the other year. But yeah, so our two big calendar items are the long lunch in October, and this year was going to be over 400 people attending, but unfortunately we've lost that event. So our next event, hopefully, depending on how the hospitality industry returns, will be the Christmas lunch. Will be a smaller affair. And then we've also got the cycling club has just launched. So there's a few, Mark Rugby, Roger Uttley, I think sort of several big names in the club are hosting cycle events that will raise money. And then hopefully next June, we'll be back in La Manga for the Golf Classic and the big Wasps Legend Cycle Challenge.
If you need anybody to carry the bags in La Manga, the 22 dropouts have already volunteered.
Brilliant, we're more that's than what we happy like to.
Yeah, well, we're really good at hosting shows, as you can tell.
I could do a live one.
Lawrence is the talkative one amongst us. He never shuts up. And Lawrence has said he will go to and all listen to his anecdotes.
No, that'd be great. He'd be more than welcome.
Is he bringing his big cock with him?
Yeah, I never forget it. I never forget it.
Will you get it through customs? Won't need no car, will he?
No, Rod, you've... You organise quite a lot of things, like as Lou's just said, the cycling events and things. What's the aim when you can get going again? What are you looking to achieve and raise?
Well, the reason why I'm involved is because I spent a long time playing rugby. The last part of my playing career was at Wasps. I got to know a lot of guys, my contemporaries, who have sort of disappeared. But I kept an involvement early on with the Wasps when I was teaching at Harrow. Used to go down there in the evenings and coach a bit with Nigel Melville, and met the next generation of players like Geezer, like Lawrence and Dean Ryan, Steve Bates, and all those boys. And have just stayed involved, really. I was around for a long time. When you're playing, rugby is all about being with your mates and the crack and everything. Once you stop playing and you've got to get on with the rest of your life, you know, you're only playing for a relatively short period of your life, then there's a lot of life left to be lived. And one of the big problems I think contemporary players have got is that they've been involved in the game from an early age, they've been used and abused, and then all of a sudden, by the time they get to 30, they end up not having a clue about what they're going to do. And it's, you know, there's a big build-up. I don't know whether I'm over-egging it, Mike, but I think there's a big problem for the game. One of the great things about the Legends, and one of the great things this past few months have shown, is that from small beginnings, all sorts of things can happen. You know, Geezer and a whole load of guys there with Scrids at the helm have managed to get together, you know, over goodness knows how many people who haven't spoken to one another for donkeys, you know, since they stopped playing, really. But being able to revive, you know, old memories and, you know, the amount of banter that's been floating around and friendships that have been re-established is remarkable. We were talking about going out to La Manga to play golf. And Scriv said, how about having a little bit of cycling to go along with it? And I said, well, I've always been interested in cycling. So I said, I'm up for that. And there are about half a dozen people who were going to ride. All of a sudden, through lockdown, we've now got the Wasps Cycling Club. And Riggers has got a ride coming up shortly. And there's only, 20 or 30 people up for that. We've already had one from the amateur club with over 30 odd people doing it. And I'm going to host one. Damien Cronin's going to host one. And we just get people involved. And the common thread is their involvement with Wasps. But all, you know, the excitement that and the passion for the game that was generated during your playing days can all be reignited and, you know, help to maintain a positive outlook. You know, I've been extremely fortunate during my time in the game. I'll be 71 on Saturday, and I did 100 miles at the weekend around the Chilterns and with Mark Rigby, another great Wasp. And, you know, so as long as you can keep doing that and keep positive and doing things and make a contribution, you know, do things because you want to do them, not because of what you can get out of it. And I think I played rugby because I wanted to do it. There was no money in it. And now there's a slightly different aspect to it all. I'm sure the guys are playing rugby because they want to do it. But there's also that element of what can I get out of it? You know, what's in it for me? And I think that breeds a slightly different atmosphere.
I think what you say is exactly right. You know, it's about that extended family. It's about supporting one another because careers are short and they're perhaps a lot shorter than people envisage when they're 16, 17, 18 years old. And like you say, you've got
to have something to... No, you can't. I went on tour in 74 as a 24-year-old. Willie John was the captain going out on his fifth Lions tour. He was 35. It was like going on tour with your dad. You know, that's what it felt like. He was so old, relatively speaking. You know, you start off as a 21-year-old thinking 30, oh, that's a long way away. And then all of a sudden, a couple of injuries later, and you're 30 and you're wondering, well, what's going to happen next?
So, welcome back to part three of the 22 Dropouts. Now, we are your favourite YouTube show and podcast, talking about all things rugby, mainly because we don't bother to take a summer break. So, don't forget to check us out on your social media, on Facebook and on Instagram. Just go and search for at 22 Dropouts. Now, of course, tonight we are being joined by the wonderful Mr. Mike Geezer Friday, Miss Lou.
That's something you came out of lockdown, yeah.
Is that not a fine, Lou? Yeah. Has he got to drink one now?
That's an announcement out the bag.
Lou, that's for you. We are joined by
the Was that right-handed as well?
It was right-handed.
We are joined by the princess. The princess of the front row, as we already know, Lou Letter and Mr. Roger Uttley OBE as well. It would be amiss of us if we didn't, given the company we're keeping tonight, talk a little bit about sevens. And given the biggest wry smile is already on Geezer's face, Mike, I think, would you like to kick this one off, sir?
What's the specific topic you want to talk about? Because sevens is a heap of at the moment.
Yeah. I mean, how certain unions have turned it into a complete pile of dog shit, to be fair.
Well, I think we're in unprecedented times, first and foremost, but I think it provides a massive opportunity. And Sevens is you know, is a game that can be utilised globally, a truly global game, not just for the what we would call the traditional tier one superpowers who run the 15s game. Because when you talk about that globally, they're only very, very small land masses. So if you truly want to reposition the game globally across men's and women's, then sevens is the forum to do that, because actually we start to access the markets, the geographies of the Americas and Asia, India and China, where, for example, on the men's side and the women's, on the sevens, Canada, USA, South America countries are thriving. But when you look across in Asia, in India especially, the women's game is growing. In China, the women's game is growing. And I think there's a real opportunity. But it's going to take a real radical thinking and evolution of the World Series, the World Seven Series, to reposition the game so it becomes accessible and sustainable. I just think we've got a great opportunity off the back of this pandemic with the Olympic dream, with the Olympic positioning of the game, of turning rugby sevens into what I would call a Formula One type of environment, which is, you know, does it mean that nations will need to think differently? Yes, I think they will. Will they have to be prepared to share the family silver with large corporate entities? Yes, I do. And do I think then we could reposition and access a broadcasting platform which would allow us not only to grow the game and show the game, but also truly, truly position the game as a global opportunity for everybody? And that's what rugby's about. The spirit of rugby is about everybody having an opportunity and a chance to excel, both in the men's game and the women's game. So it's some interesting times, because you see what's happened with England, which is basically the RFU, it's a circa £2 or £2.5 million burn for them every year. And it's, you know, do they want to reposition it to become Team GB, and England filters through onto the FIRA marketplace? Wales are going the same way. And there are a number of other tier one rugby nations that look at sevens as the snotty kid in the corner that is something we don't really have to deal with, rather than embrace it and turn it into a commercially profitable part of their national governing body. So World Rugby are at the forefront. I think if we can get through this year, where there's a lot of hurt going on, a lot of triage with what's happening, especially in England and Wales. And I do fear for some other traditional tier one countries as well, if we don't get back playing properly just after Christmas, it could be really, really desperate times. So yeah, World Rugby, we're working hard, we're pushing them. There's a few of us, as you said, I'm right at the front trying to ensure that we reposition the game and we try and grow the game and create opportunity.
What sort of support are you getting from World Rugby then?
Well, I think it depends.
Are they concerned?
I think they are concerned, but I think the corridors of World Rugby are so used to the 15s game, because it is the number one game amongst the tier one nations, but that's a small amount of landmass. That's not the true representation of the global world we have. So I think there has to be a mindset change that sevens, it doesn't need to compete with 15s. It can be a product, a form of sevens, a form of rugby that can allow us to grow the game globally, both from a corporate perspective as well as a broadcasting.
Do you think sevens should actually not focus on tier one?
I think it sits differently depending on what country you are, right? But I think the tier one nations need teams like Fiji and USA who see it as the main part of their rugby programs. But even the likes of, say, Fiji and the USA, we need the likes of New Zealand, England, or Team GB, France, the big Australia, names, because they're the big names. Yeah. And the fact that we might, our superstars like Perry Baker, Carlin Isles might be the superstars of USA rugby, and in England we see the stars of tomorrow today, it has to sit in the development pathways. I think it's horses for courses. I think that's the beauty of it. I think that's what makes it so exhilarating and different. But I think every country has to realise and recognise and know where it fits, but we've got to fund it and invest in it properly. So a player, be it a young man or a young lady, can make a career choice. Do I want to go into 15s or do I want to go into 7s? And going into 15s might create more financial reward for you. But if you go into still going to be a decent living.
Do you think they're mutually exclusive then?
I think there comes a point where a player has to make a decision. So do think sevens can be part of a 15s player's pathway? Yes, I do.
I always saw it as a developmental path, you know, for younger aspiring players. You know,
I agree.
Sevens can be as brutal, but not quite as brutal as 15s, really. You know, it's more athletic.
I do think you're right, but I think there should be room for that. I'm going to say this because I was probably one of them. A seven specialist who can be utilised to develop that young talent.
Yeah.
And I think
with
where the women's game is at the moment, you can cross between the two. But I think every year professional rugby moves on.
It's
changing.
It's
going to change and it's going to evolve. And all you see in the women's game is probably what happened in the men's game 10 years ago. And that's great. I think the women can learn all the mistakes we made in the men's game. I think the women have the forthright to be able to see that and hopefully make different decisions at different times to ensure that they're more streamlined.
But even that's changed now because with the introduction of contracts, you have to choose, really. There's none of this. You know, a few years ago, you could sort of spend 2 years playing sevens under contract because you had the Olympics, and then 2 years playing 15s under contract for the World Cup. But now you can't do that with the Premier 15s and the new contracts.
Well, that's union choice, though.
Yeah.
I mean, England could take a different view from and how it sits in their pathway, but I think that's the strategy that's at each union's discretion. You know, I think it's horses for courses, really.
Yeah. I agree. I think it can be a pathway, but I also think it's a very, very different game as well, just sharing some of the rules, some of the laws and some of the concepts. When you look at it, if you strip it all the way back and you say, right, where is the pathway for 15s? It starts with kids, it moves into cults, it goes to college, it goes to university, it goes to academy, it goes to premiership, etc., etc. The pathway for sevens is limited to people who have been spotted as potential sevens talent within the 15s pathway, and they're pulled out of that either for a few years, pulling them out because that's where their speciality lies. And it's interesting, one of the great points I think you made was about this tier one and the landmass of things and also the other countries. You know, if we look at Kenya, for example, Lawrence will tell you what sevens means to them, and particularly what sevens means when they're doing well in the World Series and beating those tier one nations. Lawrence, how does it make you guys feel over there?
Of course, it is a delightful feeling because sevens really, it's now like our 15th version. The best we can get, because our 15th teams, that doesn't really do well. But if you look at the sevens series, that period when we won the Singapore seven, and we also reached a final in the next leg, the entire country was, was just happy level. Also, when Mike was coaching us in 2014, during the Rugby World Cup, I think, and when we reached the semi-final, it was also a very happy feeling for the Kenyans. So sevens to, if I can say, tier two and tier three nations, it is like that rock that they actually cling on for, just like the Rugby Foundation.
That's their avenue to stardom. But how, you know, you talk about money within the RFU, and Christ knows there's been an awful lot of criticism over here about the dropping of the sevens. We'll put our hands up, I'll put my hand up. I think it's an absolutely shocking decision. How does that fare with the money you were getting over in the States?
Well, I think, like you said, the way that people build their programs is very different depending on what country you are. And I think, you know, as Lawrence has just touched on, when I was in Kenya, it was fanatical that you were able to beat a tier one country. And that was our whole mantra. We were able as a tier three country to compete with tier one and come away and do the job. And, you know, we had an epic year. And that was the same when I arrived at USA, where they were close to relegation. But what you've got to understand on terms of the funding is that when you look at the tier one countries like New Zealand, England and so forth, all of their sevens programs are financed from within their NGBs. They get very little outside funding from their Olympic funding areas. Whereas us in the USA, we get, I mean, very little to minimal funding from USA Rugby. And we get the majority of our funding from USOPC, the Olympics, as well as another part, which is direct philanthropy. Part of my job and role is fundraising, believe it or not, as well as coaching and arguing with referees. So
it's, never.
I think that there's very different models and structures that each nation can adopt. And I think what we need moving forward is a privatization or a corporate setup which allows all countries to be able to probably take the sevens off their cash flow books, mm-hmm. so that it's not costing or affecting what they're doing in their traditional 15s mantra, and they're able to be commercially viable in their own right and sustainable. That would allow us to drive salaries for players and the programs, which then will make it more attractive to players to consider, which ultimately then will make the product better.
Mike, do you think there's that global corporate interest though?
Well, it's no different to Formula One to F1. And you look at the fact that when you look at the seven setup, right, it's 10 cities around the world. So let's just say to run a men's and women's sevens program, it's going to be anywhere between 3 million to 4 million, let's just say. In terms of a global corporate, so if you were going to be called, I don't know, Red Bull England or Amazon USA, and you get to market in 10 cities around the world, 10 events, and be a part of a national team, from a marketing perspective, it's not a significant amount of money. Mm-hmm. And you look at the broadcasting opportunities, if they got it right on the media platform and the way that people watch sport now. And sevens is fast moving, 14 minutes. But, you know, my son doesn't want to watch every game. He'll turn his clock on to watch England and he'll turn his clock on to watch USA. So if we get it on the digital media platforms at $1 a clip, then, you know, you start to see a little bit of what goes in the NBA, what a little bit goes on in the Formula One. Now you start seeing how there's real commercial realities and opportunity for everybody to benefit from.
I agree with you. I do agree with you. If you can't stand alone and make your own way in the world, regardless of who you are or what you are, you're stuck.
100%.
Yeah. I think you talk about the tier three and tier two countries and how great it is for them to be able to beat tier one nations. Do you know it's the same for the referees? The only chance they've got really at tier three, tier two, unless they're really lucky, is to do the seven circuit. And that's the only way they're going to get picked up to be able to do tier one.
Yeah. Geezer's gone for a wee-wee. which means he's getting at Lou. And Rog, remind me he's being fined when he gets back. Because nobody skips out for a wee-wee. Lou.
That's not true. It's a good job Chris isn't here.
Chris skips out for a wee-wee, but we take the piss remorselessly. Anyway, Luke, that's a great time because...
I'm not liking your links or segues, Mike.
Lou, what I was going to say is that's a good time to shut Geezer up because we can talk about sevens all day long, but actually what I'd like to talk about is the way that the women's game's going at the moment.
Yeah, so it's a bit of a blow that Tyrrell's pulled out of their agreement, but sort of, you know, at the end of their agreed three-year agreement. I think it does give us the opportunity to rethink and look at packages. Also, timing's not great with the current situation and climate. So, you know, that is a bit, and I know the commercial teams are looking hard, and it's got to be right for the game as well. But they are if you're really committed to the game. So like everybody, the women's game will probably take a cut, but not sort of a big cut that will affect the teams as much. From a world perspective as well, I suppose we're all on tender hooks because we're meant to be in New Zealand in 11 months time for the World Cup. So, you know, is the World Cup going to happen? Is it not? Same with the Olympics. The women's Premier 15s is on its way back, but again, there's not the money or the infrastructure in there to get them back as quickly as the men. So that's the biggest step now, hopefully, in the next few weeks. they'll be back into full contact.
I think that probably comes down to things like testing, doesn't it?
To test all the 10 teams, their 40 player squads, the coaching, S&C staff, you're looking at sort of $5,000 per team. So that's, you know, $50,000 a week. And the women's game doesn't have that. The RFU does not have that money to sustain that. So, you know, it is going to be a slower return, but it will return.
Where are the women in terms of the Premiership finding a new sponsor? Is there anybody on the horizon?
I think there are several conversations, positive conversations going on. I've not heard that a deal has been made, but yeah, I would hope that before the season is out, even if before the season starts, maybe that we'll have a new title sponsor.
Tyrrell's great sponsor for a few years. That's wonderful. I think they've realised women don't eat crisps. So anybody who makes red or Prosecco or even pink wine, it's only because I've seen so many of Lou's drinking videos that I know that her Front Row Union drinks rosé.
Stereotype. No, say that's not rosé wine, that's rosé champagne.
I bow when I retire away from my princess of the front row. Do you know what? Heineken, Guinness, Krabbies,
IPA, King,
draw us up a list and we'll forward that on to all the people. As you know, just tonight, we don't
like
give a fuck.
A Moe or a Verve Clicquot sponsor. Yeah. But that's just for me.
Go up market, Lou. Go up market.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Rog, if you could choose your sponsor for your era, who would it have been?
Oh, God. Guinness. Guinness would have been good.
Go with the obvious.
Or Benson Hedges or something like that.
I thought you were about to say Double Diamond.
Well, no. You couldn't drink that. That was rubbish.
Geezer? If you could pick one sponsor for USA Rugby Sevens or 15s, who would it be?
Amazon.
Oh, you see, he's chasing the money now.
Fucking right.
Where is he? That's his job.
That's the front of the shirt. I ain't told you he's going on the back.
Okay. So, Geezer, who's on the back?
Who would I go?
I wouldn't really
give a fuck. Well, I've got, Netflix would be great. I mean, that's the type of thing probably the women's premiership wants, is that right. Type.
Hey, you can't have Amazon and Netflix unless you Prince Harry. Come on.
Well, fuck it then. We'll have him as well. We'll have Prince Harry. We'll have him on the shorts.
I can imagine you running around with Prince Harry on one side and Meghan Markle on the back.
Well, he can be called Prince Harry USA if he pays the $5 million.
Well, given the deal he's got from Netflix, he's got plenty to spare. You can have $5 million. In fact,
and he's still patron of the RFU, so we'll have his money, thanks. Yeah.
Well, we can share it, right? I mean, it's all good. He's got that much of it.
Lizzie. Hi. Do me a favour. Can you ask Harry if he'll give $5 million of his squiddy whittles to USA? He will. I'll let Mike know.
That's Premiership.
Yeah, thanks, you Madge. Thanks, you Madge. You can have it, Geezer.
I can't believe they're still talking.
Lawrence, if you could have any business on the planet that was going to sponsor Kenya Rugby, who would it be?
It'd be it'd be that drink you've got, Mike.
I said Coca-Cola.
You can't say Coca-Cola because Phil loves Pepsi. You know that. We product based Pepsi. And Steve in the USA, who is the marketing director of Pepsi-Cola, knows that we product place Pepsi. But anyway, listen, it's time to move on. So we're going to ask our guests tonight some of their funniest memories and their best nights out as part of a rugby team. And I think it's only right that we go to the Lions legend first of all and say, Roger, in 1974, what was the best night out you ever had on that tour? And I would carry on, but Roger's fucked up.
Yes, yeah. Oh. That was great timing for him to switch his camera off.
Start video, right. There we go.
Yeah, you know I'm leaving this in, don't you?
Your host has disabled it.
You just disabled a British Lion. You're fucking nuts.
Yeah, I am.
Do you know, where do you live? Do you know what?
Where do you live?
He lives in Leeds.
He'll hunt you down and he'll send Francis Emeru around. God help you.
Yeah, there we go.
Hey. So, Roger of Uttley, I humbly apologise for my schoolboy error.
Is that not a fine under your laws, guys?
Probably.
Well, he's sitting on two fines now, so yeah.
Well, you're asking me to think back a long time ago. I can barely remember what I had for breakfast, let alone 50 odd years
tell
ago.
Tell us your best story about breakfast then.
What did I have this morning? I had fruit and fibre with a bit of Greek yogurt, a couple of prunes, a few nuts and a bit of banana just to keep me going. That set me up. And then later in the morning, I had a couple of pieces of wholemeal toast, one with strawberry jam on and one with a bit of marmalade. Cooper's marmalade, which was very nice. But I was very disappointed not to get my grass cut today as well, which was it started raining.
I honestly think the older you get, the more you talk about fibre.
Talk about what?
My dad talks about fibre. My father-in-law talks about fibre. Roger Uttley talks about fibre.
Well, you're still young, you see, relatively speaking. So
thank you, Roger. I love you.
Say relatively. Lots of good times in South Africa. Different times. Didn't have to worry about people with mobile phones looking after you. And they were very pleased to see us over there and very welcoming. All the team rooms had boxes of Castle Lager, boxes of 250 boxes of Rothmans cigarettes. So we were expected to drink ourselves to death, smoke ourselves to death. But they did take care of our medical concerns because they also had bags of narches, oranges, in every team room as well. Just big straw bags of narches. So we had a mix of alcohol, nicotine and vitamin C, which was all... very helpful. It worked out quite well. One of the good things was Sid Miller was a brilliant manager, along with Willie John as captain, and they've both been around the block a few times. And they just said, "We don't mind really what goes on after matches, but you know, you just got to be there for training, and you've got to be in good shape." So we burnt the candle at both ends. So and we were out there for 3 months. I think there were 22 matches by the end. I think we're all glad to get home. But it was a great trip. And still remember JPR Williams, a great Welsh fullback, leading the Sunday lunchtime gin schools, which went before Sunday lunch, which was generally a communal thing. Could be out for braai somewhere. And they were very good. And there were lots of silly drinking games then, which has probably put me off all the EG stuff that goes on nowadays. I've got a bit beyond that, I think.
Geezer, before we come to your best drinking night out and crying out loud, there must be loads of them. You left the room earlier on. You went out for a wee-wee when we hadn't taken a break, didn't you, sir?
I did, yeah.
I think that's a fine, isn't it, Lou?
Oh, definitely, yeah.
What are you drinking as your fine tonight?
Always sponsoring.
Genius Lager, one of our sponsors.
Bloody Weir, the man.
Absolutely, and 5 pence of everything you're about to drink now goes to the Doddy Weir Foundation.
Exactly. Never should be without it. All
absolutely not.
Always drinking this.
Will you do me a favour before you just drink that, mate? Will you just show that to the camera again and say, "Hi, Sam. This is for you."
Hi, Sam. This is for you.
Ooh, lovely.
Don't forget to salute, otherwise you're going to do two.
You don't have a sponsor yet, Mike, or don't have that financial backing that you need.
Well, I've got a future, right?
I'm a bit like England Sevens, Lou.
So are we going now or what?
Go.
Are we getting this on? Right, so I am going to still salute the Wasps Foundation and also Doddy and Genius Beer, legend.
And Sam.
Well, and Sam. And let's get it on.
Lou, did you hear an EG there?
No, you don't have to say EG. He did indicate it. Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
It's an action, not a word. Off you go, Mike. Off you go. Ball's called by you.
Okay, this is to my man, Mr. Mike Friday, geezer extraordinaire, because he's called me out and he's right. So I'm leaving that there just in case anybody accuses me of not saluting.
Good half pint, Matt. Boom! There we go.
There you go.
To be fair, I watched all the geezers drinking earlier on today. I did notice just your capacity to down the pint, mate.
Thought, well,
it's like it's four gulps and it's gone.
That's a Wasps 90s trait. When you talk to some of the boys from the 90s in Wasps, that's what we were good at. So Mauler, Darren Malloy, was different gravy when it came down in the pint.
Just opened his gullet and that was it. Poured it down.
It was a joy to watch.
To be fair, mate, I now respect you more than I ever did. however, you have got to have some real classy stories from your Wasps days about nights out.
I mean, there's some.
The ones you can say without a lawyer being present.
Probably the ones we can't talk about. But there's one was known as the Wear 7, we were known as. So the Wear 7, we'd been out at a sevens competition for Wasps. We'd won that sevens competition, been out on the celebratory tiles that evening. Let's just say that things escalated out of control through the evening, which resulted in one of the players tap dancing on the roof of a car whilst the people were still in it. Which then resulted in a chase across the churchyard with police dogs, which resulted in four or five of the boys ended up in jail, three or four of us that managed to make safety. And let's just say, even those boys that were in the evening clink still managed to unlock themselves out of the evening clink and were walking the police station before they got put back into the cells. None to say we were heavily reprimanded the weekend after by some great Wasp men, John Langley, Finchie, and the other man that was on that
Finch.
The other man that was on that disciplinary committee was Mark Rigby. Oh. Now, I mean, it's irony of the highest order. So all seven of us were hauled in because we'd professed to be Saracens players when we were trying. Well, those that had been commandeered. And we had to present our case to Riggers, Finchie and Langers. Riggers tried his best to keep a straight face. And we all ended up getting suspended from playing in a Wasp tournament, the under-21s Wasp tournament, a London Irish kind of national tournament that weekend. Didn't make any difference. We won it anyway without all seven of us playing. So it was a good all-round couple of weeks. But that was kind of symptomatic of the way that those kind of the Wasps was back then in terms of the young boys. We had to live under the shadow, shall we say, or we had to live up to the likes of Rigby, Dean Ryan, Buster White, Francis Emerua, who, to be fair to him, looked after all of us at times of distress. Because it was an unforgiving environment on a training night on a Thursday and also in the bars on a Saturday. But you came through those battle scars quite well, and off the back of that we had some great evenings out. All good fun, all sometimes probably went a little bit too far, like tap dancing on a car roof, but no malice or anything like that. But yeah, we were very fortunate that mobile phones did not exist.
Yeah,
I'm sure. In the early 90s. I mean, most Sundays when we were in the Wasp cult, part of our weekend ritual was to go down to the local station to bail volley out. To get him to play on a Sunday. To get him to bail out on a Sunday. But they were the characters we were, you know. We were all blokes from different backgrounds which would come together and play at Wasps, which is what the club was about. It didn't matter where you came from, who you were, what background you had, whether you were one of the posh kids or one of the street kids. When you walked through the doors at Wasps, you were welcomed and you were told to get on with it. And if you bought into the team ethos, then you survived. If you didn't, you're probably not surviving. And that's the mantra that has stood Wasps so well. And Lawrence summed it up very well in the lockdown when we managed, as always, to bring probably 3 or 4 decades of Wasps back into the group. Is Wasps isn't a place. It's up here. It's in your head.
Other people.
And that is so true. That is so true. We've wandered around the country, but when you're a part of the mob, then you're in it.
Like you say, once a Wasp, always a Wasp.
It is, but you see, the beauty about this Wasp thing as well is, right, because there's a few of the Wasp boys who've gone across to the Sequins and vice versa. And Wasps allows everybody to be them, and they don't judge. Everybody's allowed to make decisions, good and bad. But the reality is you always look after the man and the lady that you stand next to that represents the club and who has represented the club. And that's the beauty of what the game's about, but that's what Wasps is all about. And that's what we try and transcend in the foundation and how we support the charities that we do. And that's symptomatic probably in the long lunch. But more importantly, I think probably the most special moment or the special thing that we have at Wasps is the quinquennial. Once every 5 years, decades come back to the Savoy, and you have tables of the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the thousands, the 10, you know, and it's
the whole club, isn't it? Because amateur and professional, it's just one club. Yeah.
Special night. Mm. You are welcomed. You are part of it. It's great to meet up with people that you might not have seen for 5 years.
But that's the key, isn't it? It's like, you know, being in lockdown and having all these sessions over a weekend, it's just been great catching up with people. I've found it difficult following the conversations on WhatsApp, but just little bits of video clips and the like has just made it, well, just good fun. And it's, you know, it's just a great community, people coming together, which is what we need in this time. And the fact that we've all got a Wasp connection is what brings us all together, even over the generations. And I think that's massively important. And it's one of the reasons why I'm still involved.
I think that's huge for everybody, isn't it? And it's one of the things that you guys have embodied tonight and Pete's talked about before. Now, Lou, we're not letting you off because those two keep talking. We want to know the best night out that you've had.
I don't, it's going to sound corny, but do you know what? I love the Wasps Legends Long Lunch because, again, it just epitomises just bringing everybody back together. Doesn't matter what era you played, amateur, professional, men or women. It just brings the club together for a lovely lunch, a lot of alcohol, but raising money for charity. And just it's a good night that really embodies the Wasps.
Well, it was
spirit.
A lunch.
We get food there. I don't remember getting food.
Yeah, well, you might be on the poor tables. I'll send some back next time.
love a bit of bread.
But I think, you know, I think for the women's side, it's really, it's quite difficult because we were and are still our amateur. We pretty much ran a sort of professional setup. So we didn't go out drinking after training. We didn't go drinking after matches. You know, we actually were just thinking about sort of winning the league. Yeah, a bit boring. I do remember one tour. We were in South Africa and we played sort of the first South African all-coloured team. And we, being on tour, we arrived after the match in our psychedelic leggings, tutus, and then suddenly panicked that they probably wouldn't get that we were on tour. And anyway, they never encountered a beer race. Yeah, we introduced them to the drinking elements of rugby post-game, and they absolutely loved it. And I think that's one thing that I'll remember. It might not have been the best night, but actually just sharing some of the rugby love and the rugby traditions that have built up around sort of the drinking culture, which obviously in some parts we're trying to eradicate.
drinking in moderation.
Lawrence, do these things happen in Kenya too?
Oh, they happen in Kenya. they've got in Kenya, they've got the three wise men. Johnny Walker, Jim Beam, and I'm telling you, they nearly killed me.
Lawrence, tell us about the three wise men.
I think Mike has already answered you quite well. And also, if you happen to get Rasta, he's in a good position to tell you also what happens in Kenya, but it only stays in Kenya.
The Kenyan boys are serious party animals, and I would hazard a guess Lawrence is. Lawrence, there's that place called the Vineyards, isn't there? Around the back in Nairobi.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, I'm telling you, that place is kicking. So I guarantee we'll probably find Lawrence and all the Kenya Sevens boys down there most weekends. When you get in there, it's the sort of place you'd find the Wasp boys for sure.
When we go to the Safari Sevens, Lawrence, you're taking us there.
Yeah, Lawrence, don't take them to Black Diamond. Take them to the Vineyard.
We'll go to both.
Why do I feel I'm missing out just right now?
Because you are.
Anyway, listen.
Mike, I feel on, that's a trip you want to miss out on completely, by the way they're laughing, to be fair.
We need a referee manager to come with us. Are you game?
I'll be game, but I'm very strict, yeah.
Now, there's a whole different podcast.
My jaw's still ringing from when Mr. Utley twatted me.
How old are you then?
I am 58 this month, and I played as a very young 18-year-old against you, you were playing for the North of England, and I was playing for combined services, and you twatted me off the ball and laughed.
I don't believe it.
He's still in therapy, Ron. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I got up and I thought it was Steve Smith that did me an 18.
Rod, I think you should apologise.
Roger, I think you should salute the Wasps.
Yeah, well, I'd like to salute Wasp legends because they're a great outfit. There are some interesting characters. In particular, I'd like to salute Peter Scrivener. He is a legend in his own right, principally because it was all his effort that kept the momentum going during the course of the lockdown each weekend. To Lou and everybody else who formed the Wasp Legends Committee, Mark Rogers, Solly and Nabs and Genevieve, I've had some great moments with them. So I'd like to salute all of those boys and girls, wish everybody involved in the sport. Mike, you in particular, you've got a big responsibility on your shoulders there. And I just hope you can pull something together to get something that you obviously love deeply, you know, the Sevens game, and are able to make something out of that. I think it's tragic what's happened to it, because to me, it's a great game to watch with the Olympic involvement there. You know, if you can maintain that and keep that going, that's got to be good for the game generally.
Now, we have had one of the best nights ever. I've got to say a massive thank you to all of our guests tonight, to the Lou the Princess Latter, Phil the Geezer Friday. Phil, where am I getting Phil from?
That over again. You've been drinking too much.
I better do that.
Do you know what? This is normal. Louis like this all the
time. No, because I've got you here and I've got him there and I'm going Phil. And and he's got Phil here in my screen. And I've got Geezer here and I've got... right, I'm looking at my computer now. So if my eyes go down like that, don't worry. I'm looking at the computer where I can see. So it's been a wonderful evening. It's been one of the best we've ever had, I must say. So thanks to all our guests tonight. Thanks to the Wasps Legends Foundation. And we wish them well. And if you can do anything to help out, never mind having a drink like we've had tonight, why don't you just donate the price of a beer? Go online, have a look, and we'll put the link up now. Go to their website and just donate the price of a beer, the price of a glass of wine, and help out the foundation. Thanks to Lou. Thanks to Mike. Thanks to Rog. Thanks to Phil. Thanks to Lawrence. Thanks to James. And thanks to all our other regulars who couldn't be fucked to join us tonight. But they've missed out. We are the ones that are truly blessed. We'll wish you a good night tonight. From me, from the 22, and from our guests, good night.
Good night, everybody.